So in the manual, the Church of the Nazarene, they say that the church constitution and the covenant of Christian conduct should be printed out or spoken in the church once a year. And so we are putting this out. We'll probably have these out next Sunday as well and the Sunday after that. So if anybody wants to take one of these, the church constitution and the covenant of Christian character or conduct, then go ahead and take one. They're up on the table there. I will be reading part of the church constitution today during or at the end of my sermon. So if anybody wanted one of those to read along. Elaine, would you come up? Does anybody want one of these? Okay, Connie and Teresa want one. Can you grab some and give them to them? Also, this doesn't have to be right now, but I put out some communication cards. For those that want to be like on the prayer chain or to receive the prayer chain prayer requests, go ahead and put your name and phone number, even if you don't want that, so that we can communicate with you. I have some records, but not all those records have correct addresses, and I know information changes from time to time. On the back is where you'll find the card where I had talked about in our annual meeting. If you are interested in being on the building committee or the friendship committee or being on the NMI committee, just mark that there with a check mark or whatever it is that you want to do. So that's another announcement that we have today. I'll set these off to the side now that I remembered them. So, and you don't have to fill it out today. You can fill it out at any point and bring it back, and you can just put it in the offering plate. Whenever you have it done, it doesn't have to be a right now thing. So, upcoming events, we have the board meeting on August 19th at 6 o'clock at the Parsonage. We have the men's prayer breakfast on August 21st. Remember, that is moved up a week because Adam and I and our family will be gone that last weekend of August. And then the women's gathering is on August 23rd at 6 o'clock at the Parsonage. Again, that one's moved back or moved up a week too. So just in case you have it in your mind, the last Saturday and the last Monday of every month are the men and women things. Those are pushed back or pushed up just a week. So that's that. I also have, and I forgot to say this when I said these things, I also have newsletters for August for everyone that attends here or is a member here. You should have grabbed just some extras to have. And I apologize, they didn't. This pile of, they're just over sitting over here. Everybody has one. If you, you can take your own. And if you know that you're going to be seeing someone within this next week, you can take theirs as well. But otherwise, I'm just going to stick a stamp on them. And I figured if I bring them to church and people can pick them up, then we might be able to save the church some postage, right? So if you are able to, if you are seeing someone that you know has a newsletter over there this week, you can grab theirs as well. So prayer requests we have, and I want us to pray for these. I want us to pray for these. But we have a prayer request that came in last night from Myrna. Myrna had called me. She said that her granddaughter's husband, and her four-year-old great-granddaughter all have COVID. So she wants prayers for them. They seem to be kind of in the getting better with this, but she knew that prayer was so important, and so she wanted to have prayers for them. Myrna is also having some issues with her back, and so she's supposed to go see the chiropractor on Monday, and she said, just please have the church pray that I will be able to get to the chiropractor on Monday. She said she has to go down and up two steps, and so that's a struggle for her right now. And Oh, it is so good to see Earl with us this morning. Yes, we praise God for the healing that has been done. And I know that there's still treatment that still needs to be done, but it's so good to see you this morning. Remember to keep Bev Christensen and her family in your prayers. I went and saw her on Thursday, and she's sleeping a lot. Her girls weren't there, so I didn't quite get an update on how she was doing, but it sounds like she's doing about the same as she was last Sunday, still holding in there. When we went and saw her last Sunday, she wasn't eating anymore, but she was still drinking, so we need to keep that family in prayer. Mike Johnson, we have no current update on that other than just possibly getting out at some point this month. Yes. Remember, we need to keep Larry in prayer with what's going on there, his leg and from that fall. Jeannie Norris, I'm assuming the surgery went well. Lauren, do you have an update on that? Okay, the surgery went well. And we also need to pray for Destiny. I know I got that prayer request out for Destiny. She did have her baby, and the baby does look fairly healthy, about 4 pounds, I think it was, Sherry. So she's in Des Moines. So we need to remember to pray for Destiny as she's, you know, her body's recovering from the C-section of having to take her. They took the baby early because the baby was in distress. So then, you know, all the emotions that go with that is having an early birth and not being able to be with your child. So we need to remember to pray for her heart through that situation. So I'm going to go ahead and we'll pray for these prayer requests. Oh, yes. Teresa's eye surgery on Thursday. I had that written down, but I did not rewrite that on this one. So, okay, let's go ahead and pray for these prayer requests. Lord, I just come to you today and I pray for those in our church who are needing just some extra comfort, just having your hand upon them. Lord, I pray that you continue to be with Bev in her family, her girls. Lord, I pray that you just have your hand upon them as you just continue to show them comfort and give them comfort. Just continue to show them that you're right there with them through all of this. Lord, I pray for Mike Johnson, that you continue to keep him and his company safe, Lord, as they come out of this area of war, that they get out safely, that you just continue to have your hand upon them. Lord, I pray for Earl. We just give you the praise that things are getting better, but Lord, we just pray that you continue to have your hand upon him, as you continue to guide the doctors that are helping him and the therapists. Continue to show them what it is that needs to be done. Lord, I pray for Larry that you continue to guide the doctors in that situation as well, that you help Larry and with the pain that he may be experiencing with that. Just continue to have your hand upon him and give him comfort. Lord, I pray for Jeannie that you just continue to help heal her, as you continue to help the doctors guide their hands and their hearts. Lord, I pray for Destiny, that you just be with her heart as well. Just continue to comfort her, Lord, in this time when she's just given birth to a child and that child had to be taken to another hospital. Lord, I just pray that you just continue to give her comfort, continue to show her that you're right there. And Lord, I pray for this baby as well, that you continue to have your hand upon this little girl, And that you continue to guide the hands of the doctors and the nurses and what it is that they need to do. Lord, I pray for Teresa, who will be going through this surgery on her eye on Thursday, that you just bring her comfort, have your hand upon her. Lord, I pray that you guide the hands and the hearts of the doctors that are helping her. Just show them what it is that needs to be done. And Lord, one I didn't mention earlier, I pray once again for Elaine's friend, that you continue to have your hand upon her. We are just so thankful that she is able to get the treatment that's needed. But Lord, we pray that you continue to have your hand upon the doctors that are helping her. Continue to guide their minds and their hearts. Lord, I just thank you. I thank you that you're a God that answers prayers. Lord, I just pray that you just continue to be with these prayer requests. Continue to give comfort. Lord, we just love you and we give you all the praise. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we will go ahead and get back into our time of worship. Our next song is My Jesus, I Love Thee. about that. Sometimes that computer doesn't bring up those next words, and sometimes they kind of get lost in the shuffle. Our next song we are going to be singing is There's Something About That Name. Jesus, Jesus. Get visitors up front. I really do. Next song we're going to sing. Sorry, I lost my train of thought. I was just thinking, oh, it's so cute. I love it. I love it when the little girls come up and visit me. So we are going to sing Lord, We Praise You.
Love you, Lord.
Lord, I just thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us. Lord, I just thank you that we are able to gather together and to learn more about you and to pray to you and sing our praises to you and to read your word. And Lord, I thank you for revealing to us you, yourself. And Lord, I pray that you just continue to open up our hearts and our minds to what it is that you want us to learn, Lord. We want to be students of you and to listen to what it is that you're teaching us. And so, Lord, I would just pray that you just open up our hearts and our minds to that. Lord, I pray for those who are here today. I pray for those who aren't here today for whatever reason, that you just continue to have your hand upon them. Just continue to guide them. Lord, I just pray that you continue to teach them in the way that only you can teach. Lord, I pray that you just continue to fill this place with your presence today, Lord. You just continue to show yourself to us. Lord, I pray that you just continue to be with this church, continue to guide us in what it is that you want us to do. And Lord, I pray that you be with my heart and in my words. That they aren't my words, that they're yours. I want all of me to be out of this equation, that I want it to be all of you. Lord, I pray that you just continue to show me how to do that. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
This. Oh, there we go. Try to make this switch off. I forgot to have a clip for my hair this morning. I've noticed that my hair sometimes gets in the way and I can't get this on very well.
Oh, no. Oh, no, Olivia. You okay?
Grandma's laughing. She goes, oh, it looked funny. Okay. Sorry, I'm going to take a drink real quick. I have gotten hives from somewhere, so I have taken Benadryl, so if I tend to act like I'm about to fall asleep, that might be why. I'm going to try to keep myself awake, though, with this sermon, so... But I don't know. I wish there was something. I need to find something different because I take Benadryl and then I just feel like I'm going to pass out. A lot of times I take Benadryl while I'm sitting in bed just so that if I fall asleep. Oh, am I not in my bubble where I'm supposed to be? Or is the thing blocking it? So I'm supposed to stand here? He told me I need to stand still. I don't know if I can do that. We'll try. So I want to start this sermon out by telling you a story. In 1519, a man named Hernan Cortez landed in Veracruz, so in Mexico, to overthrow the Aztecs and to take the land for Spain. After facing the opponent, Cortez's men decided that they would rather retreat. So Cortez gave an order, burn the ships. They were left with two options, and retreating wasn't one of them. To win and fulfill the mission, or to die. Those were the only two options they had. They couldn't go back unless they fought and won and built more ships in order to go back. Now, Cortez wasn't doing this for noble reasons. He was doing this for riches for Spain and fame for himself. So not a noble cause, but I think that there is a lesson in this story that we need to take to heart. that sometimes we have to commit in such a way that we burn the ships, that there's no way out. It's either do or die. And that reminded me of a quote that I had once heard in a movie. Do or do not, there is no try. By Master Yoda. Do you guys remember that part of the movie? Do or do not. When Luke goes, I don't think I can do this. And then Yoda goes, he goes, I don't think I can do this, but I'll try. And Yoda goes, do or do not. There is no try. And I remembered that as I thought about this story. And there's no half in and half out. There is no try. There is no safety net. The ships were burnt in Cortez's situation. There was no going back. Now, I know this seems like kind of a drastic story to tell, but I think sometimes we need to burn the ships, the proverbial ships that we have in our lives. Some ships are meant to be burnt in our lives as we turn to God. There should be no going back to the way that we were. We are committed to the mission. Now, commitment used to be, and maybe some would argue still is, commitment used to be a mark of Christianity, to be committed. Christian marriages were something, sorry, I got a fly visitor now. Christian marriages were something that the families wanted their daughters to marry into because they knew in a Christian marriage there was stability and there was commitment. There was no easy way out of that marriage. The man wasn't going to divorce the woman because she didn't cook right the right food or cook in the right way or step through the doorway in the right way, right? So there was a commitment in Christian marriage that wasn't in other marriages. It was a burning the ships kind of situation. They were in this together. Because if a woman faced divorce in that day, she didn't have many options. A man had many options, right? But a woman didn't have many options. And so, for a family to marry their daughter off into a Christian marriage, they knew that she was going to be taken care of. And they knew that this was a commitment, that there was not a whole lot of reason for coming back. Women that came into marriage with Christian husband were cared for, loved, and provided for. Now, there is also a commitment, another form of commitment that, you know, Christians had, which was their commitment to the church, right? So, in order to become a Christian, at that time, back in the day, a lot of Christians had to burn the ships, right? They had to leave their family. They had to leave their friends. They had to sell their possessions just to come in to be part of the church. Back in that day, there wasn't church hopping because there was one church, right? So you didn't get these different denominations. You had to sit and tough it out with the people that you were with because there was no other church around the corner. That was the church, and that was it. There was a commitment to that church. And here I've moved way up. And Adam's yelling at me. I'm already moving. So those within the genesis of the church, or the beginning of the church, were committed to the church. And they didn't take this agreement just as a willy-nilly kind of thing. sometime or something they could follow when they wanted to or when it was convenient to them. When they were committed, they were committed. They usually lost a lot for that commitment. And so it's not something that they're going to give up easily. They understood the commitment that came with becoming part of the church. And many of them were martyred because they were Christians and refused to be quiet about the things that they know were true. That was Jesus' death and resurrection, right? They would rather death than to be quiet. We read this verse last week, but I want to bring it back to our attention and look at it in a little different light. In Acts 4, 32, we'll start at 32 and go through, 35, yep. All the believers were one in heart and mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything they had. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all that there were no needy persons among them. For from time to time, those who owned land or houses sold them, brought the money from the sales, and put it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to anyone who was in need. Now, we saw at the beginning of that verse, it says all believers were one in heart and mind. Now, in this, we're not just talking about the original 120 believers that had gathered. So, did I have those verses? Yep. Okay. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120. We see that in Acts 1:15. So, at the beginning, we had this group of 120. But we know that in Acts 2:41, we added 3,000, right? In Acts 2:47, there's not an exact number, but it says, we read that the Lord added to their numbers daily those who were being saved. But we see in Acts 4:4, it says, but many who heard the message believed, so the number of men who believed grew to be about 5,000. And this is shortly before this other verse that we just read in chapter 4, right? So we're talking about 5,000 men. Now, yes, that word that is used in the Bible is specifically just men. So we're not talking women, and we're not talking children. We are only talking men, believers. Now, just for simple math, we're going to double this because we would assume that we would have at least 5,000 women and children to go along with that 5,000 men. Not all men were going to have wives and not all men were going to have children, but just for simple math, and you can argue with me if you want to on this number, but I'm going to say 10,000. So if we think about that number, 10,000 believers were one heart and one mind. 10,000 believers. We have 31 church members. Can we as a church say that we have 31 church members of one heart and mind? But they had 10,000. And why? Because they were focused on the mission. And it says, and with great powers the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them that there was no needy persons among them. No needy persons among this group of 10,000. We could say 10,000 plus people. To reference that, that's about 2.5 of Chariton. So the 2019 Census Bureau stated that there was about 4,000 people living here in Chariton. So about 2.5 times of Chariton, being of one mind and one heart, and having no needy persons among them. Can you imagine that? How did they do that? How did they do that? They knew what their mission was, right? That's how they did that. Their directive was not their own. They were all listening to the Holy Spirit and moving forward to what God called them to. There was no individual mission. They were all committed to moving forward the mission that they were called towards. They were willing to let some things, their personal preferences, fall to the wayside because of the grand scheme. In the grand scheme of things, their personal preferences didn't matter. Now, I'm not saying things were always this way, or things have always been this way. They seem to get distracted after this message, after they started out, after we see this 10,000 that were of one heart and mind, they started to get a little distracted in their thinking of what the mission was, right? And we see that through the rest of the New Testament, that they started to get a little distracted. That's usually what Paul's writing towards, is don't think about this, think about the mission, don't think about this. It doesn't matter, you know, Gentiles that come in don't have to be circumcised. So they tended to start getting off track. But in this moment, in Acts 4, 32 through 35, they were of one heart and one mind, and there was no needy persons among them. Now, I wanted to reiterate that I am, again, not saying that we have to sell our possessions and give the money to the church to give out to people. I am not saying that. But I am saying that we are called to do what God calls us to do. Whatever he asks us to do, that is what we need to be doing. If it is that God is calling us to sell our possessions and to go off and spread the gospel, then that is what we need to be doing. But I'm not saying that that's always the case of what God will call us towards. Our life, our family, our possessions, it all belongs to God when we come into this relationship with God. And we give those things, our life, our family, our possessions, to God to use in the ways that he wants to use them, to move forward the mission, his mission. We give our lives, we give our possessions, we also give our preferences. We give our right to demand it our way because we give our whole being to God to be used to further the mission, his mission, not ours. We burn the ships. There's no going back to the way that we used to be. We don't get to return. When I thought about this, I thought about that hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross," where it says, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all, right? As a Christian, we are called to be committed to the great commission that was set before us. We are called to be committed to the body of Christ, which is the church, committed in its movement forward. And we move the church forward by being of one mind and heart and looking to Jesus and not to ourselves, right? We move the church forward by linking together and taking care of those around us. And we are the living, remember, the living body of Christ. The living, breathing church by focusing on what Jesus tells us to focus on, to spread the good news that he came and died for all, and that he loves all. Now, personally, I truly feel like God has called this particular church to love in ways that Chariton has never seen before. To love in that genuine 1 Corinthians 13 kind of love. I admitted about a week ago, is that the women's thing, that people don't always want to accept help from the church because they feel like strings are attached to it. Now, I truly believe that this is in good reason. Some would argue that, oh, they have no reason to believe that. Others would argue, absolutely, they have reason to believe that we haven't been loving them in the way that we should have been loving them, and that they will feel like these strings are attached. And the reason why I feel that way is because I don't think that the church has always done a good job at loving people. And I truly believe that all of creation knows the Creator. Whether they admit that they know or accept that the Creator, God, is their Creator, that doesn't matter. They know the Creator. And when we as Christians put ourselves forward and say, we're Christians, therefore we are Christ-like, right? Christ followers, Christians. We are Christ-like, and when we don't act in Christ-like ways, they know that. They know that. Because even without them coming to church and without them ever opening the Bible, as God's creation, they know their Creator. Amen. And when we don't reflect that, they know that. And so, I think they have good reason to not want help from the church because we don't always act like God does. They feel like strings are attached to the help that church gives them. And again, like I said, we can argue whether that's true, like they have real reasons or not, but I think they do. Because they know what the Creator looks like. Whether they worship him or not, they know what he looks like. And I feel as a church, we need to get better at that. At actually reflecting the love that we're supposed to reflect. And I don't think that this issue is just a past issue, and I don't think it's just a present issue. I think it's been an issue ongoing from the beginning when we started getting distracted by different things and stopped following what it was that the mission of the church was supposed to be. Because as Christians, we aren't committed in the ways that we are supposed to be committed. We don't always look like Christ, and we don't always act like Christ. We don't always give up our lives as Christ did. We don't love in the way that God asks us to love. And we aren't always committed to the church. And we aren't always committed to each other. And in those areas, I feel like a lot of times us Christians look like the world. And when we look like the world, people aren't going to listen to us. Oftentimes, the Christian's commitment to their family or their church or the community or towards God looks very much like a worldly commitment. And if we look like the world and we don't look like the Creator, then there's no reason for people to look in our direction. Because God calls us beyond that, right? God calls us beyond that. He calls us to love in a way beyond the way that the world loves. God, our Creator, is committed to us. And the ways that He shows that is that He offers us a relationship with Him, something we couldn't have but through Jesus. God shows His commitment to us that while we were still sinners, Jesus died for us, right? God provided what in the Old Testament they called the Goel, a redeemer. God provided a redeemer who would redeem us from what would have been. God is this husband who provides us a safe place to be, who doesn't leave us and doesn't forsake us. God finds us where we are and comes alongside of us and then lovingly guides us to the place where He wants us to be. God brought Gentiles into the fold. We were grafted in, remember? And in all of that, God asks that we in this marriage, we're going to call it a marriage, be committed to Him. That we burn our ships. That we don't place anything above Him. That He asks us to spread the good news of the gospel, right? The Great Commission. And He asks us to spread His love, the greatest commandment. God asks that we be committed. And God asks that we come into and help forward the body of Christ, the church. That is through using our talents to work with others and their talents to move the church forward. We come alongside the church and support the ministries of the church. And we also support the church through our membership to the church. But membership in a church isn't something that should just be taken lightly. Membership with a church is a covenant, a commitment to that church. Now here in the Church of the Nazarene, there are a few things that we ask and certain things of members in the church. And this is how we, as the Church of the Nazarene, feel like this is the best way to move the church, the body of Christ, forward. Here in the Church of the Nazarene, we ask that members conduct themselves within the covenant of Christian character. And I will read part of that now. To be identified with the visible church is a blessed privilege and a sacred duty of all who are saved from their sins and are seeking completeness in Christ Jesus. Right? Do you guys get that? To be identified with a visible church is a blessed privilege and a sacred duty. It is required of all who desire to unite within the Church of the Nazarene and thus to walk in fellowship with us, that they shall show evidence of salvation from their sins by a godly walk and vital piety, and that they shall be or earnestly desire to be cleansed from all the indwelling sin, that they shall evidence their commitment to God in these ways. Paragraph 21.1 says, first, by doing that which is enjoined in the word of God, which is the rule of both faith and practice, including loving God with all the heart, soul, mind, and strength, and one neighbor as oneself, pressing upon the attention of the unsaved and claims of the gospel, inviting them to the house of the Lord and trying to compass their salvation, be courteous to all people, being helpful to those who are also of faith and love, forbearing one another, seeking to do good to the bodies and souls of people, feeding the hungry, clothing the naked, visiting the sick and imprisoned, and ministering to the needy as opportunity and ability are given, contributing to the support of the ministry and the church and its work and tithes and offering, attending faithfully to all the ordinance of God and the means of grace, which we talked about last week, including the public worship of God, the ministry of the word, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, searching the scriptures and meditating thereon, and family and private devotions. Now, second, so that's all the things that we need to do, right, as members of the Church of the Nazarene, or if you want to become a member of the Church of the Nazarene. And second is what they say we should avoid. Avoiding evil of every kind, including taking the name of God in vain, profaning of the Lord's Day by participating in the unnecessary secular activities, thereby indulging in practices that deny its sanctity, sexual immorality such as premarital, extramarital, or same-sex relations, provisions of any form of looseness or impropriety of conduct, habits or practices known to be destructive of physical and mental well-being. Christians are to regard themselves as temples of the Holy Spirit. Now, one thing I think that gets us every time that we agree to not do, remember? Quarreling, returning evil for evil, gossiping, slandering, spreading surmises injurious to the name of the good name of others. Dishonesty, taking advantage and buying and selling, bearing false witness and like works of darkness. The indulging of pride of dress in dress or behavior. Our people are to dress with the Christian simplicity and modesty that becomes holiness. Music, literature, and entertainment that dishonors God. And third, the way that we show what we need to and things that we need to do on this list of things we need to do or not do. It says, third, by abiding in hearty fellowship with the church, not inveighing against, but wholly committed to this doctrine, to its doctrines, sorry, that should be its, doctrines and usages of activity involved in its continuing witness and outreach. So, paraphrase. We need to love others, right? We need to love others. That's what all that is, paraphrased. We need to love others. Because in all those things that we're supposed to do, it shows that we have a love towards other people. And all those things that we shouldn't do, it shows that we have a love towards other people. And we're supposed to commit to the church. And that commitment isn't something that's taken lightly. Now, I understand that's a lot, but that's how the Church of the Nazarene feels we can best move forward together, focusing on a main goal, loving others, which is to bring more people to the wholeness through a relationship with Jesus Christ through loving others. Now, as a church, I feel like we can get to the point where we are one heart and mind. We can do it. If we allow the infilling of the Holy Spirit, for the Spirit to guide us, not ourselves, to guide us. I believe that if we all die to self and allow every part of ourselves to be used, we burn those ships and allow God to take it where it is and where he wants us to go. If we burn those ships and allow God to use us. And if we can all here in the church agree to that we can be of one heart and one mind and move forward without getting in the way of the Holy Spirit. But we have to trust God in that. It's not always in our timing that we want things. It's not always going to look the way that we think that things should look. But if we truly, truly get out of the way and let God move in the ways that he wants to, beautiful things will happen. But we have to be a one heart and one mind. We have to burn the ships. Anything that's trying to hold us back, we need to get rid of. And move forward with God's guiding, right? We are once again going to close out our Sunday service with "Your Love Compels Me." And those that can, I would ask for you to stand as we sing this song. We are going to sing this song, "Your Love Compels Me, Lord, to give as you would give, to speak as you would speak, to live as you would live, to see as you would see, to serve as you would serve." Today we talked about commitment. We need to be committed to God in the ways that he's committed to us, right? We need to be committed to the body of Christ and moving it forward. And that means getting ourselves out of the way and allowing him to work in this church, right? Let's go ahead and sing this song, and then I will pray, and then you guys will be dismissed.
Your love compels me, Lord, to give as you would give, to speak as you would speak, to live as you would live. Your love compels me, Lord.
Lord, I just thank you for this day. Lord, I just thank you for everyone who's here today. I pray, Lord, that you could just continue to work on our hearts and our minds this week. Just continue to show us if there's things that we need to get out of our lives, Lord, in order to come better in alignment with what it is that you want for us, Lord. We pray that you show us those things. And that we have the courage to step back and burn those boats and not go back that way. Lord, I pray that you just continue to speak to our hearts and our minds this week. Show us how to love the way that you love. And Lord, I pray that you just continue to show us how to give as you would give and to speak as you would speak and to live as you would live. And Lord, I pray that as a church, that it is your love that compels us to do those things. Lord, I pray that you just continue to bring this church into one heart and mind, that we move forward in your mission, what it is that you want of us, Lord. Pray that you just continue to guide the hands or the minds of the leadership, that you just continue to speak to the leadership within this church, not just within this local church, but within the Church of the Nazarene, and that you speak to the leadership in all churches, Lord, and continue to show us what it is that you want us to do. We can all move forward together. It's not just our church, Lord. It's every church. It's your church. It's the living body of Christ. Not just the Church of the Nazarene. Lord, I just pray that you just continue to show us and guide us and be with our hearts this week. Be with us as we leave this place, Lord. Bring us back here safely next week. Lord, we just love you and we give you all the honor and praise. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We will have a special guest next week. Lauren is going to be giving the message next week. I appreciate him doing that. We're going to be coming back from vacation next Sunday, but we won't make it in the morning. So Lauren's going to be doing that. So please come back next Sunday. We'll see you guys.